Thanks for the presentation and the opportunity to give this talk. So I will present you the Reinforce project, which is H2020 European project. So okay, a quick overview of my presentation. I will start with a general presentation of Reinforce. Then I will describe the four main science work packages we have in Reinforce. And finally, I will take the example of the work package I am working on, which is a Deep Sea Hunter work package, to show you what we can do, what we want to do with the citizen scientists, and how we will use the Zooniverse platform. So Reinforce is a short for research infrastructure for citizens in Europe. And it is a pretty young, let's say, project because it has started at the end of 2019. I give you the website here if you want to have a look. And let's say that the main goal of Reinforce is to minimize the knowledge gap between large research infrastructure. I am going to explain this a bit later. And society through citizen science. So we have four, let's say, sub main goals, which are the change in awareness and understanding of basic research and its impact on society, development and knowledge of new knowledge, sorry, and innovation by citizens. And of course, with this project, we also want to develop some indicators to see what is the impact of our activities of citizen science activity, but what also would be the cost and benefit of citizen science activities. So if you do some data analysis in your work, you know that statistics is a good thing. So we want to involve a lot of citizen scientists, so more than 100,000, in order to have good indicators about these activities. So here I show you a very simplified schematic of citizen science. Citizen science is at the interface between the research world, and in our case, for Reinforce, large research infrastructure, and the society world. So we can suppose that by increasing the size of the citizen science world, we will increase the number of links between the research world and society, and we will also increase the robustness of this link. So more practically, what we want to propose to the citizen scientists come from the fact that for some tasks, humans are just better than computers. So for example, to notice some features and some data, to identify, to classify images in different categories. And also more pragmatically, let's say, for some tasks, we are not just enough in the research world. So we need a lot of help from citizen scientists. So I give you here a list of all the work packages we have in Reinforce. So don't worry, I will not go through all the list. You have mainly the work package displayed in black are the management packages, the packages that will develop the indicators to assess the efficiency of such activities, the cost and benefits of citizen science. We have displayed in green the four work package, scientific work package that I will describe just later. And we have also a work package here displayed in blue, which is so increasing the senses. And the aim of this work package is to develop frameworks and tools so that disabled people could do science, to could do the citizen science activities we are proposing. So for example, we are developing a software which is called SonoUno, and the aim of this software is just to sonify data, so any kind of data, spectrum, any kind of data, so that blind people, for example, can hear the data instead of looking at it. Okay, so now just a representation of the four work packages that we have. and the activities we want to propose to the citizen scientists. So the first one is called gravitational wave noise hunting. So it's in the context of a gravitational wave interferometer. And the aim here is to better understand the noise that we have in this kind of detector in order to eliminate them from the data. So what we are going to propose here is pictures of noise so we can't really manage to classify, and the citizen scientists will try to classify them into different categories, create new categories, and things like that. The idea of this is the feedback from all this activity will help to train machine learning algorithm and to improve noise rejection in useful data. So the second science work package is called Search for New Particle at LHC. So in the context of the ATLAS experiment, and here the idea is to try to identify the new particles. So I have an example here. I don't know if you are familiar with this kind of view, but on the bottom, you have here the front view of the ATLAS detector with the calorimeters, the beam at the center, and the side, you have a lateral view. And the idea here is to locate and identify what we call displaced vertices. So for example, you can see that the yellow tracks here and here, so this is the same track, the vertex is not at the center of the beam. So it can be a clue for a new particle. Then we have a work package that is called cosmic muon images. So in the context of muon tomography, which is a non-invasive and non-destructive process that we use in geology and also archaeology, for example, to monitor the inside of volcanoes or to try to find hidden chambers, for example, in pyramids. So it's a very nice technique. And here what we want to propose is to try to identify tracks in the muon detectors we are using. So sometimes you have data, you don't know if this is a track or not, and the human eyes can better identify if this is noise or not. So here you have an example of the Zooniverse platform that I am going to show later. And the idea here is that the citizen scientists can draw lines on the plots, and then after we can extract the coordinates of this line to, for example, to reconstruct to get some properties, characteristics of the tracks. And the last one, so the Deep Sea Hunters work package, this is a work package I am working on, and I am going to describe it into more details in order to show you what we can, what we want to do and how we are using the Zooniverse platform. So in Reinforce, there is one thing we want to emphasize on is a large research infrastructure, because sometimes it's not well understood by society, in fact. So I take the example of KNET, so which is a kilometer cube neutrino telescope, and it is indeed a large-scale research infrastructure because of two facts, let's say. The first one is by the number of people involved in the collaboration. So you have a map of all the involved countries. This is an international collaboration. And we have now more than 57 institutes and groups involved in this collaboration. It is also a large research infrastructure because of the size of the detector. And here we are deploying, currently, in fact, we are deploying two huge kilometer cube scale detectors. So one is near Toulon in France. So it is called ORCA for oscillation research with cosmics in the abyss. And the second one is called ARCA, which is deployed near Sicily in Italy, and which is called astroparticle research with cosmics in the abyss. So just to what we want, also what we have seen, thanks to polls we have made online that some infrastructure are not well understood. So we want also to explain first, before proposing some activities, we want to explain what are the detection principles of this or this detector. And okay, I remind here briefly what is the detection principle of the neutrino telescope. So we have three main sources of events. The first one is cosmic neutrinos that are coming from all the universe. The second one is what we call atmospheric neutrinos, which are in fact produced by the interaction of a cosmic ray with the atmosphere. And the third main source of event is what we call atmospheric muons that are also produced by the interaction of a cosmic ray with the atmosphere. And what is interesting with neutrino telescope is that in fact we use the Earth as a detector, because at the energies we are looking at, only neutrinos can cross the Earth. So more precisely, what is a neutrino telescope? You have a sketch here of KM3NET, and it's a 3D, three-dimensional array of photomultipliers that we deployed in a non-opaque medium, like water, for example. So KM3NET is deployed at the bottom of the Mediterranean Sea. And thanks to these photomultipliers, we want to detect what we call the Cherenkov radiation. This is a signature, in fact, of a charged particle going faster than light in a medium. And the idea is that you can see here on the example, the neutrino is interacting near the detector. It produces a muon, and then we can detect this muon. And thanks to the neutrino telescope, we can reconstruct the energy and direction of this incoming neutrino to point the origin on the sky map. Okay, so I give you here. Yes, it's not working in full screen. The video. Okay, so I give you here an example of the data we are taking. And here you have, so we have currently deployed 6 lines at the bottom of the sea for the ORCA detector, and we are taking data. And you can see a few examples of neutrino candidates here. And what you can also see is that some of the modules we have are randomly flashing in this video. And this is because we have noise in our detector, and it will be the starting point, in fact, of the project behind the work package number 4. So let's go back to full screen. Okay. So the idea also in Reinforce is to show that we build a detector to detect something, and the idea is that we can do something else with this detector. So for example, as I will show you, with the neutrino telescope, we can do sea science. With a gravitational wave detector, we can do seismology, for example, and things like that. And this is something that is not, sometimes not understood by society. If we think neutrino telescope, okay, it means we want to detect only neutrinos, but this is not the case, and we want to show this by example. What we want to do in the deep sea enter work package is to work with what we call noise for neutrino physicists, but that is not noise for sea science scientists. And for example, we can detect what we call bioluminescence in our PMTs, but we can also detect acoustic signals that are emitted by cetacean in the Mediterranean Sea. So with the deep sea hunters, we want the help of citizen scientists to classify the bioluminescent signal and bioacoustics. So it is really interesting because, for example, for the bioluminescence studies, it is new studies, in fact, and there is a big potential of interesting discoveries, in fact. And thanks to the input we are going to have from all this classification, it will help us to improve our noise identification machine learning algorithm, and this will help us in the end to do also neutrino science. So just to give you a few examples of the data we will show. So concerning the bioluminescence, the ID of this project is to identify known and unknown bioluminescent species just by looking at the characteristic of the emitted signals. So you have here a few examples of different kind of signals. So you can see that depending on the species, it can, for the same time window, it can emit a lot of peaks, small size peak, or it can emit a few peaks, but with a large scale. Then concerning the bioacoustic part, the idea is that all cetacean emit acoustic signal for communication, prey's location, for example. And because in CAMTUNET we have acoustic devices, we can detect these signals. So to go more into the details, we use in fact acoustic devices to do the positioning calibration of our detector. So you can see here you have an image of the monitoring of the position of all the detector we have at the bottom of the sieve. So you can see the six line we have deployed, and we have like this, thanks to acoustic triangulation, we can have a live monitoring of the position of the dome. So with this acoustic devices, we can detect acoustic waveform from sea mammals. Okay, so now I will show you briefly the Zooniverse platform if you don't know it. So for the work package number 4, we have developed one, but there is also one for each of the science work package in Reinforce, and I will use the work package number 4 example. So here you have it's an intro front page with a title, a small introduction about the project, and if you click on learn more, we have written an explanation of the project and the science behind the Deep Center. So you have a main fact part, and you have also a part with more details about neutrino astronomy, messenger, multi-messenger astronomy, and also bioluminescence and bioacoustic signal. We have also the team tab, just to describe, as I have said before, what is a large scale research infrastructure. So we describe here the KMTNet collaboration, and we also have a description of all the participants of the work package number 4. And then, let's go to the page. We have also the workflow, which are the classification tasks that we propose to the citizen scientists. So for this workflow, we need to provide tutorials just to explain what we want the citizen scientists to do. We can't just give the data and look at it and say if there is something useful. We explain what we want to do, we explain the context of the data taking and things like that. And mainly for the two workflows we have currently. So just a reminder, this is in fact, it's a beta version of the demonstrator. Of course, it will be improved with further feedback from the team, but also from citizen scientists. So for now, what we want to do is to classify bioluminescence and acoustic signal in two different categories. And because this is a bit new for us, because we don't necessarily know the tools, we have tried to implement a different task for each categories in order to see which one would be the best to identify each characteristic. So I will show you directly for the bioluminescence what it looks like. Okay, so the idea is you have a plot like this. Over 2 minutes, you have the rates of our PMTs, and you can see that we have peaks, and these peaks are bioluminescence peaks, and we can classify them into 4 categories. So just let me go to demo mode. Okay, and here I will say we have a multi-peak category, and I count 4 peaks. Okay, and now I can highlight the peep by drawing rectangle. What is interesting for us is that from the properties of these rectangles, we can extract the useful information, for example, the baseline, the size of the peak, and also the height of the peak. And you see it's pretty fast to do, and then we can do other classification. Concerning the acoustic part, what we have implemented so far is this. So I haven't shown you the tutorials look like this. So you have a few examples and explanation behind all the plots. And what we propose is a time sample of 5 seconds and amplitude versus time and frequency versus time. And then we propose to classify what we see into 5 categories. And here, because I have read the tutorial, I know this is a Street Dolphin clicks sample, and I can, this is just for the purpose of the demonstration, I would not count on the peak. And then I need to highlight where I can find the peak. Okay, next. And I will show you just a nice example of the kind of signals we can have. This is a nice, very nice signal of sperm whale clicks. So we know that because of the interclick interval and because also of the frequency range. So let me play. Maybe I need to share. Where is it? Share computer sound. Okay, and let me play. Okay, so you should have heard the audio file. I'll play it again. So you can hear some what we call clicks, which are produced, in fact, by sperm whales. So this is really interesting. Okay, and I go to my presentation. And okay, this is what we have implemented so far for the Zooniverse demonstrator. I leave you on my conclusion in a bit over time. So of course, Rainforest is a huge project. And I hope I gave you a nice overview of this project. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rémi. It was very interesting and already well advanced for the demonstrator. So how do you plan to contact the citizen scientists? Do they just come by themselves on the website?
Yes. So there is one more package, I think, dedicated to this. This will be done through usual social media like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. And we will, implement a different channel of communication regarding for this. And what is really interesting for us is that I didn't know before of this Zooniverse platform, but apparently, this is a very well-known platform for citizen science. And so it gathers already a lot of people. And through, let's say, publicity, through Zooniverse, we also expect to have a lot of citizen scientists involved in this.
Okay.
So please, Claire, if you want to ask your question.
Yes, I confirm. Zooniverse is really a must, and they have a full community. So just the fact that you're on Zooniverse, boom, it will go.
Yes.
But now, from the experience we had in a project that we did in my experiment, the volunteers also want to learn and discuss and find out. So in your project, do you have some sea animal specialists who can answer the questions?
Yes,
because once they find something strange and they really want, and they start to do groups, it's a very interesting sociological thing that they start to discuss between themselves, and some start to become more expert than the others and explain to the others and so on and so forth. So the fact that you are really between the two disciplines, how are you going to handle this?
Yes. So in fact, I didn't discuss about this, but for the bioluminescence part, we have now... we have now two bioluminescence experts that have joined the project, And we are contacting also a bio acoustic expert. So I don't know if you know Hervé Glotin, which is working. So he is a well-known bioacoustic expert. So we have contacted him. He's interested in the project. And we have also two people working in CanTrinet, but on acoustic data only. And they have some experience on acoustic data. So very interesting.
And I have another small question. Yes. First of all, when are you supposed to launch this? And the second question is, the number of projects is set, or is Reinforce supposed to be a platform that then expands or continues?
So for the final demonstrator, we are supposed to launch them in May 2021. And for the second question, this I don't know. I suppose that we have now four science work package, but I suppose that if someone wants to propose a work package, we can include it in Reinforce. I don't see.
May 2021 is tomorrow, so.
Yes, but so you see for the. Work package number four, we are almost ready to produce, as we say in English, to mass product event to show to the on the universe. And this is almost also the case for the other work packages. We are well advanced on the demonstrator. It will be tight, of course, but we can do it. I'm pretty confident about this.